Hello everyone, I welcome you all to my day 4 Angular tutorial. Myself Anil Kar, I am having 6 years of experience in IT sector. I am here to help you in learning Angular concept. And I would like to inform you that before uploading this video, I already uploaded 3 more videos on Angular. Please go through that video, those videos before watching this video. In my previous video, in the day 3 Angular training session, I covered the routing concept along with some basic concept on service. Today we'll explain the concept of service little more along with error handling in the service. So please try to code with my explanation, so that we'll be in the same page. So for today's session, I have included one extra link in my navigation bar, the user link. If you click on the user link, you will get a list of users which is being displayed in a tabular format. This table contains ID of user, name of user, and whether that user is active or not, having a header as customer list. So these are my users which are using my application, my website. So these are the list of users. So I paste this user list from a JSON file. As we do not have a database or API, so I have created one JSON file having some hard-coded user data, and I am fetching that data from the JSON file. So for that, what I have done, so in our project structure we have an asset folder. In that asset folder I have created a user.json file in which I put some hard-coded user data. So there are 4 user data. So we can consider this as a database for time being. So here, like in today concept, we learn how to fetch the data from the database using API. So as we do not have the database, so we are using a JSON file having some hard-coded data, and we need to fetch the data from the JSON file using HTTP request. Okay. I guess up to this everything is clear. Then I have created one more service called as user service. So as I explained, we usually create a service within a service folder. This is a correct way of creating a service, or we can say this is the correct folder structure. So within this service, we already had created a product service.ts file in my last video. So for today's session, I have created a user.service.ts file. Okay, so in this service file, I have a function called as getUser. This getUser is a function having a return type of observable, and observable is returning an array of user records. As I explained already, observable is a collection of data, is a lazy collection of data. So it's my observable is a collection of data, and that collection contains user data. And this array of users is coming from this user.json. We'll fetch the array of users from this user.json file. So in this function, I have to use get request of HTTP method. So for that, we have to create an object of HTTP client. So by using dependency injection in the constructor, you have to use modifier private, then any name of your choice, XYZ. Usually you prefer to name as HTTP colon, then the class name HTTP client. This HTTP client we need to import from @angular/common/HTTP. Okay. Then after we dependency injected the HTTP client, we have to refer to this HTTP using this keyword, this.http. Then we have to use get method. If so, there are different methods of HTTP call, like get, post, delete, put. If you want to delete a record from the database, we have to use delete method. If you want to update a record in the database, we have to use put method. If you have to create a new record in the database, we have to use post method. If you have to only fetch the record from the database, we have to use get method. So we are just fetching the data from our database. Here database for time being is the hard-coded JSON file. Okay, so that's why I have used the get method. this gate method will return will fetch an array of users. So that's why we have given here array of users, and this user means this is a user interface. I already like explained TypeScript is a strongly typed language, and for the array of object or object we have to create our custom type. That is by using interface. So all the interface we usually create in a model folder. In the model, if you expand, you will get the user.ts file, which is an interface of type user, and these are the property of interface. And this property, as you all already know, this property corresponding to the property of user object in user.json file. Okay, user ID, name, active. Same as user ID, name, active. Okay, so here we have created an interface. Okay, so in the service, we are referring to that interface, because this get method will return or will read or will fetch an array of users. Okay, then we have to give the API URL. So I have created a class variable API URL in which I have given the path of the JSON file. The JSON file from which we want to read. Usually here we will give the path of API URL. So API URL will be provided by the backend team, and you have to use the API URL here. And API URL, API URL, most of the API URL are starting from HTTP or HTTPS. Or just like the below URL, you can say. This is the proper API URL. For time being, we don't have any API, so that's why we are reading from our user.json file, which is in the asset folder. So once we get the API URL, we will initialize our API URL variable here, and we have to use this API URL in our get method. So what it will do, this entire statement will give an observable, will read the user.json file, and it will return an observable. So this will be always the HTTP method will return an observable. That observable we have to return from this function by using the return keyword. So as this function is returning an observable of user, that's why the return type of this method is observable of user. Okay. So up to this user service is done. Now we need to call this method from the component which required this user data. And we require this user data in user component. I already have created a user component, and you very well know how to create a component from Angular CLI. I already covered in my previous video. So I have created a user component. We'll open user component.ts file. So here we need this user.json data. The data that is being hard coded in user.json file. We are reading this data by using this HTTP get method. So this function is returning those data in the form of an observable. So we need to call this function. So for calling this function, we have to dependency injected the service. Since we have to create an instance of that service, this is the syntax of dependency injection, which I have already explained in my previous video. Then what we have to do, in the ng-onInit method, usually in ng-onInit method, we have to call the function of that service. Here we have created the instance of the service, then we refer to that instance by this dot instance of the service dot function. This is the function which is being available in the service file. This function which is returning an observable. So up to this, it will return an observable. So observable is a lazy collection of data. Why lazy? Because unless and until we subscribe to the observable, we won't get access to the data in the observable. So we should subscribe to the observable to fetch tree to get the data from the observable. So once you subscribe, observable will emit the data that it contains. Okay. So this will return an observable. We need to subscribe by using the subscribe method dot subscribe. Now this variable contain our array of users. It will contain the record that is being stored in the observable, which is an array of users. Once you get the array of users, we have to initialize this to our class variable. Why we have to initialize to the class variable? Because after initializing, we need to display this variable in our HTML page. That's why we need to initialize to the class variable. Okay. Then once we initialize, we'll go to our HTML page. Then the same story repeats as in my day 3 video. We have created a table with some header, ID, name, active. Then we have, for the record, we have another tier element in which we are using *ng4 directive. We are iterating through the users of users. So this is the syntax of iterating through the array of objects. Here we will get each user object. We will access the property of user object by using object.property.userid.name.active. Okay. So in this way we are displaying in a tabular structure. The new thing to learn here is how to use HTTP call. Okay. So this is how we can fetch the data from the database. Okay. So one thing I forgot, like here when we are using HTTP client in the service, we have to import the HTTP client module in our app.module.ts file. If we'll open the app.module.ts file, and if it's a module that we will find in the import array, here if you see HTTP client module is there, that will be imported from /angular/common/HTTP package. Okay. So let me again explain what we have to do for fetching the data from the database. The step one is we have to import HTTP client module in our main module app.module.ts file. We have to mention that in the import array. Then we have to import this same module from /angular/common/HTTP package. This is the step one. Then we have to create a service. Let's suppose I have created a user.service, and as I explained already in my previous video, whatever the service you will create, you need to declare in the provider array of the module. So I declared that user service in my provider array of app.module.ts file. This is the user service, just as we declared product service in my day 3 video. Okay. Step 1 is we have to import the HTTP client module. Step 2 is we have to create a user.service file, and we have to declare that user.service in the provider array. This corresponding to the class of user service. Okay. User service here. This is the class of user service, and we provided that in the provider array. So the app.module.ts file changes is completed. We'll close that. Then in the users.service.file, we have to create a function, any function of your name, having a return type of, as we are returning an array of object, array of users. So the return type is observable of type users. Why it is observable? Because we are using HTTP method. An HTTP method in Angular returns observable. An observable is a collection of data. Here data means user data. And this user is a interface that we have created in the model folder, and we have to import that user interface here. Okay. Then in that function we have to call the HTTP GET request. For calling the HTTP GET request, we need to create an instance of HTTP client by using dependency injection. And HTTP is an instance of HTTP client, and we have to import the HTTP client from @angular/common/HTTP. And please don't be confused. In app.module, we have imported HTTP client module, but in the service, we have to import HTTP client, not HTTP client module. Okay. So once we create an instance of HTTP client, then we have to call the respective HTTP method, whether it is a GET, DELETE, POST, depending on the requirement. And this get to the HTTP GET method or POST method or DELETE method, we have to provide the API URL. This API URL will be being sent by the database team, by the backend team. And as we don't have any database or backend, so I have one user.json file in the asset folder, in which I declared the hardcoded username, user data, therefore user I declared, and in the API URL I am referring to that user.json. So we can visualize this user.json as a database containing the user records, and now we referring to this database by using this URL. And this URL we have to provide to the HTTP method, and this will return an observable of users. That observable we have to return from the function. As it is returning an observable of user, that's why the return type of the function is observable of type user array. Okay. Up to this clear, this is the third step. First step is app.module.ts file changes. Second step is we have to create a user.service.ts file. Third step is we have to create a HTTP instance of HTTP client, and we have to call the respective method by providing the API URL. Up to this I think everything is clear. And the last step is we have to call this service method in the respective component, in the component where we need the user data. Now in our application we need only user data in user component.ts file. That's why we will call this method in user component.ts file. For calling that method, we have to create an instance of user service by using dependency injection. We have created an instance underscore user service of user service class. Then in the ng onInit method, we have to call the getUsers method of user service. This is the getUser method which is returning an observable. As observable is a lazy collection of data, we have to subscribe to the observable to get the data. Now this contains the array of users that we will have to assign to our class variable. We have created a class variable user of type user. So this is a model that we have already created. Okay. Once we assign to the class variable, then we will go to the corresponding HTML file, user.component.html file, where we have to use *ng4 to display the user's record in a tabular format. That's it. That is how we can utilize, we can consume the API URL, and we can fetch the data from the database. Okay. So up to this, everything is clear, I believe. So next we will cover, so up to this we have learned how to fetch the data from the database using the API URL. Now like we will see how to handle the error. So in most of the cases, like while fetching the data from the server, from the database, you usually landed open with some server side error or client side error. For example, if we will land open on 500 server error, 404 page not found error, request timeout error. So these are the some of the errors that we usually face while fetching the data from the server. And let's suppose if we have not handled the error in our application, and user is using our application, and because of some issues, let's suppose the server is down and user is trying to access our application, but user is not getting the data in our application, or our application is not working properly. So user will be confused, it will decrease the interest of the user in using our website, because user could not able to know why the website is not working. So for the better user experience, we have to handle this kind of error, and we have to give a visual feedback, or we have to notify the user about the issues, why the page is not working properly, why the website is not working properly. So it means we have to handle both client side and server side error, and we have to notify the user if some error occurs, so that it will improve, it will enhance the user experience. Okay. Now we'll see how we can handle those errors. For handling those errors, what we have to do, we have to go to the service file. So this is the statement which we have written without any error handling. Now we need the error handler in our application, so we have to comment this, we have to uncomment the below code. If you see in the below code, so in the above code we have written up to this. In the below we have written another extra line by using the pipe function. Okay, so we have two functions, retry and catch error. So we'll come to the retry first. So For using the retry, we have to import the retry from RxJS slash operator. Okay, this is the function provided by RxJS library. It is one of the important functions. What it will do? Let suppose this HTTP GET request will send a request to the server, from the client to the server. And because of some reason, the request get failed. And if we have written retry 1, it will try to send the same request again, one more time, if it failed. If we write retry 2, after it failed for the first time, it will try 2 times, until and unless, like it will try till 2 times, until and unless it gets success. If it gets success for the first time, it won't try for the second time. If we'll give retry as 0, then if the request to the server get failed for the first time, it won't be retried. It won't be sent again. It will directly go to the catch error function. Okay. So we usually prefer to give retry 1, because once it failed, because of some issue, we should try to send the same request again. Maybe at that time, server get ready, and there will be high chance of minimizing the error if we will try one more time if it fails for the first time. So usually give retry as 1. Then let's suppose after retry also our request get failed. Then it will jump to the catch error function. This catch error is again provided by RxJS slash operator library. RxJS library. Okay. In the catch error function, we will handle the error. For that, we have given the parameter, we have given a callback function, the handle error. Handle error is a callback function for the catch error function. And handle error is your customized function. You can give XYZ function name. Okay. So this is our customized function, which is having a parameter of error object. So whenever our request to the server fails, it usually return an error object. And this is the error object. An error object have different property like status, status code, message, URL, API URL. So all those property are there. So in handle error, we basically handle the error and throw the error, so that the respective component will notify the user about the error. So here we have created a local variable error message, which is of type string. Then in the error message, we are storing error.status, whether it is a 500 error or 400 error or 404 error, along with the error.message. So status and message are property of error object. Then once this error message is like, once we store this content in the error message, we have to throw that error by using the throw error function. Throw error is a function again provided by RxJS library. Okay, which we have to import here. Clear? So we have to throw that error and we have to return that error. Why? Because if we throw that error, then only in the respective component we can notify the user about that error message. Okay. So what does that mean? That means in the user component.ts file, here we have subscribed to the get user function. So this block of code you can say, will be executed when our request to the server gets success. And the below block of code will be executed when there is an error, when we land open on some error in our HTTP during our HTTP request, or when the server gives an error while doing some manipulation in the database. And those kind of, if we will get the error, then we will alert the user about that error. And this error contains the content of error message that we are throwing. If in the error message we will write XYZ, then in this error we will get XYZ and we will alert the user. Okay. That's why we need to throw the error message from here, so that it will be again cached here and alertify the users about the error message, so that user will know my website is not working or I am not getting the data in my website because there is some issues with the server side. or there is some issue with the code from the client side or server side, or the server is down, something like some user friendly message we will send to the user, we have to notify the user. This will enhance the user experience. Okay, then so we'll see how it works. For that I need to remove some code from app.module.ts file. This is the code, we'll come to this code later. For time being we'll remove, I have to save it. Then user.service, I have to introduce the error intentionally. So this API URL is working fine, so I will comment this. I will uncomment this API URL, so it will give an error. So here this is one, this is the practical API URL, and this API URL is no longer exist now. So this is URL created by someone else, and this URL is not exist now. So for this URL we will get 404 error message. Okay, so here we are trying to access that URL, but that URL is not present in the server. So the server will return a 404 error, that will be handled using the cache error function, and we have to from that error object we will retrieve the status and error message, and we'll throw that error message, and in user.ts file we'll alertify the user about that error message. Okay, so let me save it here. So we'll go to our C. Once we reload our user page, we are not getting any data in our table because the API URL does not exist anymore, and we are alertifying the user about the error code as well as the message. This error code and message is displaying because we have extracted it in the handle error function, error code and message. So instead of writing this technical message, so most of the user could not able to understand like this message HTTP failure response for this URL. So in order to avoid that, what we can do, we can write any hard coded message here, like page not found, please contact your administrator, all kind of user friendly message also we can hard code it here. Whatever we will hard code, that will be available in error, and that will be shown to the user by using alert box. Okay, so now once again I will go to the product, everything is working. If I will go to the user, it will send a request to the server, but the API is not existing anymore, that's why we are getting 404 error, because that API is not existing anymore. This will alertify the user. Now the user will know I am not getting any record, displaying no rows to display, because there is some issue with the server, and it improves the user experience. If you won't alertify the user about the issues, then the user will be confused, and this decrease the interest of user from using our website. So this visual feedback, this alertification is necessary for the better user experience. So for this alertification we need to handle the error. Okay, so there are two ways of handling error. First way we already have seen, by using the catch error and throw error, by using the catch error and throw error function. So the one disadvantage of this is, like, let's suppose if I have more functions. Currently I have only one function in my service in which we have called HTTP request. Let's suppose in my service file there are more functions in which we have called HTTP request. Then for each HTTP request we have to implement this catch error and handle error function. So this is like repeated code. Let's suppose we have another service file. Let it be order.service.ts file. In order.service.ts file, there will be another function in which we need to call the HTTP request. There also we need to implement this catch error and handle error. So everywhere, every service, and for every service function, we have to repeat the same code. So it's unnecessarily we are repeating the same code, the same redundant code. To avoid this, we need something, some global error handling, so that we'll handle the error at one place, and it will be workable for all the HTTP requests. So here comes into rescue the HTTP interceptor. See, the use of HTTP interceptor is mainly for global error handling. Okay, so there are lot many uses of HTTP interceptor. We'll come to that. So first of all, let me explain what do mean by HTTP interceptor. Okay, so whenever we send a request from client to the server, or whenever the response comes from the server to client, then both the way the request goes through the HTTP interceptor. For example, let I am sending a request to the server for fetching the data. So the request goes from the client, from the browser, to the HTTP interceptor, then to the server. Then the server will execute that API, then it will send the response to the interceptor first, then from the interceptor to the client. Then we will able to see the data in our browser. So HTTP interceptor, we can say middleware, through which all the HTTP request goes from client to server and comes back from server to, and the response comes back from the server to client. So it is the best place of handling the error. If you write the error handler in HTTP interceptor, then it will be applicable to all the HTTP requests, because all the HTTP requests will go through this HTTP interceptor. So that's why HTTP interceptor is used for global error handling. Write once, it will be applicable for entire application for all the HTTP requests. Okay. And another advantage of HTTP interceptor is, like, if you want to implement security in our application by using token. Let's suppose in my application I have a create button, delete button, and edit button. And I don't want to give permission to all the users to delete, edit, or create the records. So I have given permission to some user, and some user do not have the permission for creating or editing the record. How we can achieve this? By using the token. So whenever a delete request or any card request, create, update, delete request goes to the server, it will check whether that user has a permission for that operation or not. If the user has permission, then that operation will occur. Otherwise, server will send unauthorized access, or you don't have the correct permission, something like that. So for this permission check, we need to send the token. Token contains the permission of user in all HTTP requests. So we need to send the token with all HTTP requests, so that the permission contained in the HTTP permission contained in the token will be checked before doing any CRUD operation. So how we can send the token with all the HTTP requests? If we include the token in the HTTP interceptor, like all the requests go through the HTTP interceptor, we'll write the token implementation in HTTP interceptor, then that token will be included in all the requests, in all the HTTP requests. So for token implementation, for including the token in for all the HTTP requests, we use HTTP interceptor. And let's suppose third advantage is, like, let's suppose I want to change the content of my header. Okay, so if you want to change the content of the header of HTTP request, we can do in HTTP interceptor. We write there, and it will be applicable to all the HTTP requests. So in our today's session, we will concentrate on global error handling provided by HTTP interceptor. Okay. If we are using HTTP interceptor for error handling, then we don't have to write this cache error in all the HTTP GET request. So we'll comment this, we'll uncomment our previous code, because we don't need that cache error in all the HTTP request. So So in this way we will avoid the redundance of code. Then what we have to do, we have to create an interceptor. So interceptor, for interceptor I have created one ts file error-interceptor.ts file. So it's a class error interceptor which is implementing http interceptor, and we have to import http interceptor from @angular/http. Okay, so this is a class implementing http interceptor. As http interceptor is an interface, so the condition, like if any class is implementing any interface, that class has to implement the function of that interface. So http interceptor interface has one function called as intercept. The intercept will take parameter like request and need two parameters, one http request and another is http handler, and it will return an observable of http event. Okay, then in this function, in the interceptor function, what we have to do, we have to handle the request. So if we translate this in normal English sentence, what it is doing, the handler, http handler, it's handling the http request. Okay, next.handle, that handle the http request. Then we have written here the code, the error handling code that we earlier had written in the service within this function. Okay, the same code we have written here in interceptor. So here we have implemented the error handling, and it is the at one place we will implement, and it will be applicable to all the http requests. And here also we are throwing that error message so that it will be handled in the respective component where we want to alertify the user. Okay. So let me save it. So in this way we have created an interceptor. So interceptor is a class implementing the interface HTTP interceptor. And this interceptor interface has a method called intercept. It takes two parameters, one HTTP request, second HTTP handler. It returns an observable of HTTP event. Then we have to handle all the requests. Then we have to implement the error handling to that request so that it will be applicable to all the HTTP requests, because all the HTTP requests goes through this interceptor. So after creating this interceptor, we need to declare this interceptor in the module so that Angular will know there is a interceptor. So we usually declare it in the main module, app.module.ts file. Let me open that. Okay, so let me uncomment the code. Sorry, let me revert back my code. So this is the code that I had removed. So if you see interceptor, for declaring the interceptor, we have to declare that in the provider array. So we have to create an object having a property provide, in which we have to give the constant http_interceptor that we have to import from /common/http, the same package from which we have imported the client module. Okay, then the subject has another property use class, in which we have to give the class name of interceptor. This is the error interceptor corresponding to the class name. Okay, then the third property is multi, which is true. Why it is true? Because in our application we can have more than one interceptor. So this interceptor for global error handling, another interceptor we can have for token inclusion, third one for changing the header, likewise. So that's why we have to give multi true. Okay, so this is how we can declare an interceptor in the app.module.ts file. And also we have to import this error interceptor. Okay, here we have imported. So we have to create a interceptor class. We have to implement the interceptor method of HTTP interceptor interface. Then we have to declare this HTTP interceptor in the provider array of app.module by using this syntax. That's it. Nothing else is required. And if we will again go to the user component.ts file, here we are alerting the user about the error message that we are throwing from the interceptor, this one, okay, that we are throwing from the interceptor. Same error message we are displaying here, so there is no change in this section. So advantage is we have retained the error handling code in one at a global place, at a single location, at the interceptor level, so that it will be applicable to all the HTTP requests. Okay, so we will see that also in action. So if you see in user service, we already have the API URL which is a wrong URL which is no longer exists. We will see, we should get the same alertify message. So here we are getting same alertify message. Let me save it. Okay, we are getting the same message. If you go to the product, first of all we need to close this alert message. If you go to the product, we are getting the correct record. If you come to the user, we will get the alertify message because there is a API error. Okay, so this is the advantage of using HTTP interceptor for global error handling, and error handling is necessary for our application to enhance the user experience. So today we have covered how to fetch the data from the database by using HTTP client, and how to subscribe to the observable to get access to the collection of data in the observable. Then we have learned how to cache the client side and server side error by using the cache run throw error at the service level, as well as through the HTTP interceptor, that is global error handling. Okay, so today we covered all the topics that we need to cover, and I request you to please practice all this concept thoroughly, and please subscribe to my channel, subscribe to my video, and please like my video, share my video, and if you have any doubt, please write it in the description section. Thank you guys. We'll meet again with some new concept on Angular in my day 5 Angular tutorial. Till then, do whatever you want to do. Just practice this code. Thanks guys. Bye.